In this edition of Art Loft, an unusual alliance produces the brothers Beckett.
An episode of Friends meets like a Judd Apatow movie.
A local dancer taps triumphantly into town.
I've always had angels that showed up throughout my whole life. Dance saved me.
One man's noise is another's music.
And in this type of music, like 15 minutes is pretty much enough.
And loose lips reveal personal stories.
In Miami, sex is always just around the corner. Those are the words of my Cuban friend, Jose.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft. I'm Kalyn James, and this is Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation.
The brothers Beckett has been described as the odd couple for the slacker generation. The show made its world premiere as part of the Alliance Theater Lab's 2011 season and received a ton of critical acclaim for the creative team behind this company. As part of the Theater Up Close series at the Adrienne Arsht Center, the brothers Beckett makes an eagerly anticipated return.
There's a couple of things that I want to try, because my feeling is that here in the very first, the minute that the lights come up, it feels a little staged to me to have him just right there on the bunk. So I was thinking earlier today, what if we started with you, just to try it, what if we started with you in the bathroom? Okay. And that first line, Dave, is calling to him in the bathroom to get him to come out, and then just come out.
Brothers Beckett is a play about two brothers who graduated from Yale, and they live in Hoboken, New Jersey, in a pink studio apartment on bunk beds. And it's about them getting through their codependent relationship and how it effectively destroys other relationships around them. When I thought about the last name, I thought of the alliteration. I also wanted to throw a little bit of a Samuel Beckett spin on it because of the way the play starts and ends, and also because I like the last name. It's just a good, strong Irish last name too.
Yeah, me and my sister, we lived on bunk beds for a while.
You actually have a brother? Been there?
I don't have a brother. A lot of the brother stuff comes from just a few friends of mine, my dad. Because me and my dad have a very brother relationship.
There's Brad Beckett, the older brother, which I'll be playing again. And then there's the younger brother, Kevin Beckett, played by Gabe.
Okay, good.
Because it sounded to me like a rhythm is starting.
My name is Mark Della Ventura, and in this production of Brothers Beckett, I'm company manager, and I'm also playing the role of Doug.
I just won the lottery!
Doug is a neighbor to the brothers, and he's kind of like their best friend. He's the guy that gives them a lot of advice. He's the guy that comes in to use their bathroom because he clogs his own a lot. He's just the guy that consoles them, that tells them what to do when they need to hear certain kind of advice. He's just that person, a bright light in their life. The good thing for me in this is that David and I are the only two actors reprising the roles from the original, so I get to work off of three brand new actors, which forces me to make completely new choices, you know, because the way we really act and work is we really work off of the other actor. And having three new actors is forcing me to just create new choices for Doug.
And that's always the trick, is that if you guys see what you're talking about, then we as an audience see what you're talking about. You know? So that was really, really good. I really enjoyed that.
We're not trying to recreate anything we did 2 years ago. We're making it what it is now with these actors, what we know about the play, what we learned from 2 years ago, the changes that David made after the original production. So it's a brand new production of Brothers Beckett.
There is a theme of the odd couple. You know, you have one who's got a job, getting things together, has a relationship, and the other one who's this slacker, unemployed, has no business trying to find, you know, the love of his life. But so in that sense, I think there is an odd couple quality. But I think the brothers are, where it is very, very different is that they are very similar. And where they find the conflict is when they are at odds.
This time it lights up. Do you want to try and back at the bed or back in the bathroom? Or somewhere else?
I liked it in the bathroom. Why did that choose you guys?
Almost like a friend, an episode of Friends meets like a Judd Apatow movie, because we talk like we do now. There's a really common sensibility for 20 and 30 somethings.
So as much as the themes can be very dark, there's a lot of humor in it, and a lot of very, you know, 20 to the demographic we're looking for is for a new wave of theater goers.
The mission statement just kind of evolves with whatever the ensemble wants to do. You know, we want to create work that challenges and provokes and engages our audience, but we kind of just mold to whatever we feel the community wants us to do and whatever we want to express ourselves. And 2012 was an original season, and then we got asked to bring Brothers Beckett to the Arsht Center, and this is our biggest project and adventure to date.
Yeah. The roll the dice if you did. Double sixes.
All right, let's stop just one second. Let's go back to the Joyce line. Where does his train of thought go there? Why does Joyce pop into his head? Why does he go to the thought, Joyce would agree with me?
I don't know, last time I got, oh, you know, the women don't fare well in your plays. And I go, well, this particular character who was based on someone else didn't fare well in my life, but that doesn't mean she's wrong about everything.
You know, David's really good at making you laugh for about 45, 50 minutes, and then all of a sudden a couple punches will come out and you're like, that's it. And David's really good at that. It gives you something to think about, and it gives you a lot to laugh about.
The Brothers Beckett will run through March 24th at the Carnival Studio Theater, and you can find out more information about the Alliance Theater Lab, including announcements about the rest of their 2013 season, at thealliancetheaterlab.com. And now here's a look at some other arts events happening this week around South Florida. Frank Falestra is known to his friends by a much more colorful nickname, but he's also undoubtedly the king of noise, as each year he holds an annual celebration of noise at Churchill's Pub in Miami. Art Loft got an earful when we caught up with Rat at this year's International Noice Conference.
The International Noice Conference, it's in its 10th year. It's an annual event where we invite musicians from around the country and some from abroad to perform here in Miami to do more, you know, avant-garde or noisy or, you know, different types of music. It's a four-day event. The first two nights are the Miami locals. The third night is more the Tampa, West Coast, Florida, South Florida artists generally. And then the final night is mostly national and international groups. Most people that look at Miami now, they look at hip-hop conventions and DJ conventions and electronic festivals. And we were actually around long before that. We've had people from Australia, Canada, Paris, France, England, yeah. Well, for all 10 years, we held it here at Churchill's Pub, and I've been here for years doing all kinds of noisy avant-garde music before then, and then we decided to put a festival together to invite people from around the country to come down and mix in with the locals. We prefer no laptops, you know, every once in a while you might see one, it depends on the artist. We just want more of action type of sound, people that are using their bodies or using instruments and something more live, something you can see rather than just someone staring at a laptop and playing a grid. You'll see a lot of conventional instruments, and yet you'll see a lot of like primitive items like contact mics or pieces of metal or whatever, you know, they think they can generate sound on. They're experimental mostly. They try to do more maybe performance art mixed in with sound, or just an experimental sound that's trying new ideas. We try to keep it at 15 minutes or less, so we can have more performers perform. And in this type of music, like 15 minutes is pretty much enough. I mean, 8 minutes seems like forever if you're actually playing this stuff. We get a pretty good range of all kinds of people who are interested in music. They're just people who have open minds and they're curious about different sounds and want to see something new. The crowd's pretty much involved. You'll see the crowd like hover around the artist. There's a lot of networking going on. Some new artists that come down, and then there's some of the older artists that's been down for like 10 years. They always come up with a new idea every year. It's like they challenge themselves to come up with something new every year, and it's usually a surprise. It kind of mixes the Miami artists with these national artists and some international artists. It gives them a chance to see what's going on in these other cities without leaving this one. We've actually toured the event a couple of times. We went out through the United States. We play about 30 cities in about a month. We've actually gone to Europe and did about 15 cities in Europe. To have an open mind, you're gonna see some interesting music that you probably thought you'd ever hear. And the way they present the music is interesting as well.
The International Noice Conference is, in fact, international. In addition to touring 30 cities in the U.S., the INC has dates in Europe and Asia. For more information, you can visit squelters.net. And now, here's a look at more arts events happening this week around South Florida. When Jalon Lambert was growing up in Miami, he had dreams of being the next Michael Jackson. But his Miami return was tied to another musical icon, Fela Kuti, and he has a featured role in the National Touring Company musical based on the life of the Nigerian singer.
My name is Jalon Lambert. I am of Haitian descent and born and raised here in Miami, Florida, and I am a citizen of the world. 1995, I went to the Juilliard School, graduated with honors. I was there during the golden era of that institution. I was fortunate to be under the tutelage of Benjamin Harcarby, who had a very broad and open understanding and enlightenment. I was part of the first National Broadway tour of Fosse under Ann Reinking, and that was a remarkable and wonderful experience. First job out of college. I've done about 4 or 5 different one-man shows. I work very closely with a choreographer, director, scholar named Reginald Yates, who's a Guggenheim Fellow. I've traveled to Ghana, West Africa as a Jerome Foundation Fellow. And now I am with the hit Broadway musical called Fela. That's about a Nigerian political activist, band leader, a rousing rebel of a composer, and it feels really, really good to be home and to talk about this show coming back to Miami. I play the best friend of Fela, and his name is J.K. Brema. I get to be a tap stylist, dance artist using the vein of ballet, contemporary modern, with the Bill T. Jones aesthetic. And I get to also sing and act and bring my improvisational skills to the stage. And it's very engaging. It's a lot of energy, a lot of work. I started at a small dance studio called Dance Exchange Incorporated that was run by Linda Rogers Alberton and her partner, Jaji Ferretta. I walked in one day and I asked, if you guys have any work study or scholarship program, because I'd really love to learn how to dance like Michael Jackson. She looked at me, she said, well, we have to see if you're talented and then we can talk. I passed the audition. I've always had angels that showed up throughout my whole life. Dance saved me. You can fall prey to really negative influences. And I have friends that have been killed by violence, gun violence, even as recent as last year, my cousin was shot to death. So those things are close to home, and I'm really thankful for my art form allowing me to grow and to do something productive.
Shallan's career highlights include a Young Arts Presidential Scholar in the Arts, training at the Ailey School, the Broadway Theater Project, the Joffrey School of American Ballet, and he's appeared with the Martha Graham Dance Theater. Fela has a limited run through March 24th at the Adrienne Arsht Center. And now, here's a look at what happened this week in arts history. Lip Service, True Stories Out Loud, is a bit of a local phenomenon. The brainchild of two Miami natives, Lip Service asks regular people like you and me to contribute their true stories about dealing with life in South Florida, and then having the courage to read them out loud in front of live audiences. I know I don't want to air my dirty laundry, but the result is often hilarious, frequently touching, but always true.
Lip Service is a night of true stories out loud. We collect stories from anybody in the community. They have to be true. They have to be personal. And those storytellers have the chance to get on stage at the Miracle Theater in Coral Gables and share their stories live with an audience.
More than 6 years ago, I came from LA where there's a storytelling night, like seriously tons of them. And but I moved back to Miami where I'm from, and I was sitting around at the cafe at Books and Books, and I met this bearded man, wear jeans, beard. We were chatting, and I asked him if there was any place in Miami where people could tell or hear true stories. He turned out to be Mitchell Kaplan, owner of Books and Books, and he was like, "Ooh, I love that idea. Why don't you do it here?" And so in November of 2006, Lip Service started at Books and Books. And it's grown and grown and grown. We grew out of the space at Books and Books. 250 people were shoving into the aisles. And so we moved to the Miracle Theater, and now in the last show, 500 people showed up and paid to see our show. Our show's good.
The stories run the gamut. So you have stories that are funny, stories that are sad, tragic, embarrassing, shocking. But what we mostly look for is a story that's compelling, first of all, where the event that takes place is remarkable, and then most importantly, where there's some sort of journey that the storyteller has taken through the experience. So where they've learned something, where they've changed, where there's a narrative arc. So we are tied to the traditional literary definition of a story. But what makes ours different is that they're true and they're personal. So it's very intimate.
And it is amazing this stuff people are willing to share out loud.
Terrence was great. We loved his story on paper. And we loved it even more when we met him at rehearsal. He was so nervous. And he's a FedEx driver.
He was just like this regular dude standing on stage telling his story.
One of our favorite, whenever we collect audience surveys, shows and shows later, people still say that Terrence was one of their favorite stories.
In Miami, sex is always just around the corner. Those are the words of my Cuban friend, Jose. Not too long ago, I found sex in Hialeah, literally on a corner. Rosa was an older woman, probably in her 50s. She sold cold bottles of water at a busy intersection in a part of Miami that never makes it into travel brochures. She was a beauty once. You could see that in the way she carried herself, like a woman who was used to being looked at. But Rosa had lived a hard life. That was obvious, too. The sun had done its work on her skin. Her long hair was going gray. Her body had rebelled a long time ago. She still made an effort. Rosa painted her tired eyes dark blue. She wore dangly earrings and white stretchy pants. She reapplied bright red lipstick throughout the day. When she smiled at me, I could see the red smear across her teeth. Every workday for 6 months, I pulled up to Rosa's intersection in my FedEx delivery truck. I was always sweaty and in a rush. She would hurry over, slide open the door, place a cold bottle of water in my lap, and flash her red teeth at me. "No money, gratis," she said. She only knew a handful of words in English. My Spanish wasn't much better. But Rosa stood by my door until the light turned green, smiling and chatting and calling me names like mi cielo, mi vida, and mi amor. She said she got hungry working at the intersection and mentioned she loved McDonald's apple pies. But she couldn't leave her spot because someone might steal the water bottles from her coolers. She kept me hydrated for free. I fed her pies. Rosa told me about a man named Pablo, who controlled the neighborhood. Pablo kept a close eye on Rosa and took part of her earnings. When I asked her questions about Pablo, she squinted and backed away from my truck. ¿Tú trabajas para Pablo? I assured her no, I was not on Pablo's payroll, but for the next few days she seemed uneasy. Pablo, she said, es muy malo. I asked nearby business owners about Pablo, but no one had heard of him. I asked about Rosa too. Everyone said she was crazy. A young woman approached my truck at Rosa's corner one day and asked about the nearest FedEx station. I wrote the address on a slip of paper and handed it to her. Rosa was watching from the sidewalk. Later, when I stopped at the intersection again, Rosa demanded to know why I had given my phone number to that. At that moment, I realized Rosa was odd, but our interactions never lasted more than the length of one red light, so it was difficult to pinpoint the exact nature of her quirkiness. One day, she put her hand on my knee and asked, Papito. ¿Cuándo vamos a hacer? Then she said a word that I didn't understand. I'm sorry, I said, no entiendo. She thrust out a hip, made a fist, and pumped it sideways in the air. She said, Ju, me, chaka, chaka. I froze. Chaka, chaka didn't need translating. Pero I summoned the best excuse I could manage in Spanish. Tengo un amor a la casa. I have a love at home. But you are young, she said. You should have many women, not just one. I fumbled for a response. Rosa patted my hand and said we could talk about it tomorrow. The next day, Rosa pretended not to see me and my giant FedEx truck. She ignored me for the rest of the week, too. Finally, she came to me with a question. Papito, you are gay? No, I said. She pointed at my crotch. You have problem? No, no problem. Entonces, she pumped her fist. Why no? I'd had a week to think about how to let her down gently. Because of Pablo, I told her. Rosa's eyes opened wide. ¿Te dijo algo? No, I said. He didn't say anything to me, but he's dangerous. I don't want trouble. She nodded. Pablo es loco. Then the light turned green. The next day, I didn't see Rosa. I didn't see her for the rest of the week either. I asked a nearby security guard if he'd seen her. He told me she'd been hit by a car during the weekend and died. I checked online and found a small item about a pedestrian who was struck and killed. The article didn't print her name, only the driver's. It wasn't Pablo. Whenever I pass that corner now, or buy an apple pie, I miss Rosa. She was, for me, the embodiment of Miami. She had a playful spirit, zero inhibition, a well-worn but still hungry look, and she told unverifiable stories about a man named Pablo.
Lip Service is currently accepting stories for the next reading, and you can get information on how to apply or screen older stories from previous shows on their website at lipservicestories.com. And that wraps it up for another edition of Art Loft. For more arts and culture, visit WPBT.org, where you'll find feature videos, blogs, and information on upcoming arts events. Until next time, please stay creative. I'm Kalyn James, and thanks for watching.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation.